disaster surgery. The disaster surgery, we'll see about these common features of major disasters. In that, they gave one summary box. In that, what they gave is massive casualties, damage to the infrastructures, and a large number of people requiring shelter, panic and uncertainty among the population, limited access to the areas, breakdown of communication. There's no MCQ from this, just a note because it is given the summary box. Okay, and next MCQ is what are the factors influencing relief effort and the provision of the medical aid. In that, first MCQ is, which is critical for the authorities to respond quickly to a disaster. Okay, so which is very critical to respond quickly to a disaster is good communication. Okay, so the good communication is critical for the authorities to respond quickly to a disaster, that is MCQ. So next, we'll go next to what are the factors influencing rescue and relief efforts. This is another MCQ. So these are all other following factors influencing rescue and relief factors, except like that they will ask question. So first one will be your status of communication. How is the status? And then is location, whether it's rural or urban. Third one is the accessibility of the location. Okay. And fourth is a time frame in which the disaster occurs. And fifth one is economic state of the development of the area. So first one is communication, second one is a location, then accessibility to the location, then is a time frame in which a disaster occurs. Okay. And economic state of the development area. Everything is important factors influencing rescue and relief efforts. Next, what are the sequence of relief efforts after a disaster? This sequence itself is a MCQ. They can change the sequence and ask. Okay. So the sequence you have to mug up. So first you see, it's very easy only. First sequence, the sequence first step is to establish a chain of command. Okay. So next, second is your setup lines of communications. So third, you have to carry out damage assessment. How much damage assessed you have to assess. After that only, you have to mobilize the resource. After that only, you have to initiate rescue operation. Okay. So rescue operation comes fifth step only. Okay. So after that, triage casualties and seventh, start emergency treatment. After that, you have to arrange evacuation. And the last one is start definitive management. Okay. So these are the sequence, what you have to do. First sequence, establishing a chain of command. In that, they gave one flowchart. What is the organization for the? So what is the organization chart for the disaster management? In this, everything will be controlled by the chief of operation. Okay. Among he, it is divided into two. One is medical services and the other departments. Okay. Among the medical service, what are the things comes under medical services? That is MCQ. So first one is a management leader. Okay. And second one is a triage leader. Third one is evacuation. So fourth one is communication. So this communication, evacuation, triage leader and management leader come under medical services. So which is not coming under the medical services means your security, transport, search, rescue, okay, search or rescue and the communications and all won't come under this medical services. But communications they have given in medical services and here also, just look into it. The other three, security, transport and search or rescues will not come under the medical services. Okay, in that management, in the department under the management leader, yeah, they're divided the wounds into immediate treatment, urgent treatment, minor treatment, and a morgue based upon the color. Okay, what we are given the triage. So they are one other they are given here is coordination. Just remember this also can be asked. Okay. The coordination also is coming under the topic of management leaders. Okay. So next sequence of relief of efforts after a disaster. First, you finish the establishing a chain of command. We establish the chain of command, then only you have to go for the damage assessment. The damage assessment, the first objective in the disaster management is an assessment of the damage. Okay. So see the word first objective in disaster management is assessment of the damage and the number of the casualties. Okay, this chapter is full of story like that thing only. Somewhat I have managed MCQs. Okay, let's move it. So first objective in disaster management is an assessment of the damage to under the number of casualties. So next you have to mobilize the resources. Okay. So although all modes of transport need to be considered, the helicopter provide the quickest access. So we can tell all the things. They will give all the options, a train, bus. So helicopter provides the quickest access for the first responders. Okay, that is MCQ. In the rescue operation. Okay, rescue operation, what is the first priority you have to give? The first priority is to prevent further damage from occurring, both to people and to the infrastructure, not treating the patient. The rescue operation means you are not going to treat the patient. First, you have to prevent further damage from occurring both to the people and to the infrastructure. That is a rescue operation. Okay, so suppose you are seeing the patient with the head injuries and the abdominal and the thoracic trauma will either have been treated or have succumbed to their injuries within 48 to 72 2 hours of a disaster. So after the first week, the only casualties requiring treatment are those with complex limb trauma and
someone is waiting.
So patient with the head injury, okay. So those who and all will be treated within 3 days of the disaster is head injuries, abdominal thoracic trauma, because these are major traumas. And after the first weeks, the only casualties requiring treatment are only your complex limb trauma and infected wounds. Okay. Next is your coordination with the relief agents. In these 3 MCQs are there. Okay. So after your rescue operation, okay, you should not go directly to triage casualties and all. First, after that, you have to coordinate the relief agencies. Okay, the relief agencies, there are 3 relief agencies as are mainly. One is RAPID. Okay, the another one is other one is ICRC and Oxfam, and the third one is UN agencies. So what does these 3 agencies will do? What is the main role of these 3 agencies? So RAPID is a rescue and preparedness in disaster. It's mainly deal with the search and rescue. Okay, that is MCQ. They are mainly involved in the search and the rescue, whereas your ICRC and Oxfam provide general disaster related relief. Okay. And your UN agencies deal with the medical care, food provision, and refugees. Okay. So once I'm taking RAPID deals with the search and rescue only. And your ICRC and Oxfam related with the provide general disaster related relief. Okay. And the UN agencies deal with the medical care, food, and refugees. So this what you have seen already before itself, the abdominal chest trauma head injury will be encountered within 72 hours. The limb injuries can be encountered within 1 week. Okay. That already is 1 point only. And this is Oxfam team. Okay. And ICRC team and Oxfam team is mainly for providing generalized relief. Okay, MCQ. Okay. And which agencies will mainly responsible for the food, medical care and all? Your UN agencies. Okay. And dealing with the media. Okay. So there's not having any MCQs. Anything, Rishikesh?
No
MCQs I have found. And triage first MCQ. So triage is a term derived from the French verb. It's a trierer. Its meaning means too short. Okay. So French verb trierer, too short. I don't know about things. So this is a the main motto is the greatest good for the greatest number. So they can change the word and they will give options. So just to mug up it, the greatest good for the greatest number. Okay, two greatest is coming. Greatest good for greatest number. So and the numerous studies show that only 10-15% of the disaster casualties are serious enough to require hospitalization. Okay, 10-15% is very important. So then to go about to keep pace with the challenging clinical pictures on injured patients, the triage needs to be undertaken in the field. Okay, that is also very important. So where you have to take the triage? Okay, not in the hospital. Okay, you have to take the triage in the field itself before evacuation at the hospital. Okay, the triage should be conducted in the field. That is MCQ. So next
triage area. Triage should be conducted in 3 places. One at the field. One before evacuation and one at the hospital.
Okay.
Because of the changing physical state of the patient. That's why that is what they tell you. Patients change physical state will keep on changing now from one place to another place. So try at the patient in all three places like they tell you. And undertaken by the senior who can make critical decision.
Yeah, okay. So it should be taken in the field before evacuation and at the hospital. Okay. So triage areas, no more MCQs. It should be conducted in a place where you have a good water supply, lighting, and a separate area should be reserved for the patient holdings, emergency department, and medical national story only. So practical triage. So emergency life-saving measures should proceed alongside triage and can actually help the decision-making process. Okay. So you have to do the emergency life-saving process also in the meantime while you are doing triage also. Okay. Then documentation of the triage. So accurate documentation is an inseparable part of the triage, and it should include basic patient data, vital sign with the timing, brief details of the injury, and the treatment given. So these are the following inclusions where you have to document in the trial. Okay, basic patient data, vital signs of the timing. Okay, and the brief details of the injuries. Okay, preferably on a diagram. Okay, and the treatment given. Okay, so the system of color coded tags attached to the patient wrist. Okay, or around the neck should be employed with the emergency medical services. The color denotes the degree of urgency with which a patient requires a treatment. Okay, so triage categories. All methods of the triage use simple criteria based on vital signs only. Very important MCQ. Okay, so the rapid clinical assessment should be made taking into the account the patient's ability to walk, their mental status. Okay, so the presence or absence of ventilation or capillary perfusion. So these are the what we are using for the rapid clinical assessment. So we commonly used to four tier system triage is there. So this is already everyone knows only. In that first tier, second tier, third tier, and there is no fourth tier. They are given as a grade zero, priority zero. Okay, so first priority, second priority, third priority, and the last priority. Okay, and this code word is given as a zero, not four. Okay, just remember. And the color you already know. So red, yellow, green, black. So red indicates immediate. And yellow indicates urgent, and green non-urgent, and black is unsalvageable. So in the clinical status, overall red color means critical but likely to survive if treatment given yearly. Okay, example: severe facial trauma, tension pneumothorax, profuse external bleeding, hemothorax, flattened chest, and major intra-abdominal bleed. Okay, so major intra-abdominal bleed will comes in red, whereas your ruptured abdominal viscus, okay, your ruptured abdominal viscus comes in great second priority. Okay, comes in yellow color. Okay, and the extra in head injury, extra dural hematoma. Okay, EDH. The EDH will come under red. That's very important. EDH. We'll think that EDH will operate later, but the EDH is comes in red color. Everything we already know. Flattened chest, this profuse external bleeding, hemothorax, pneumothorax, severe facial trauma. So who and all urgent? The yellow color means critical but likely to survive treatment given within hours. Okay, that's common fracture, degloving injuries, ruptured abdominal viscus, pelvic fracture, and spinal injuries. Okay, so green, non-urgent. If they are stable patients, they're likely to survive if the treatment is delayed for hours to days. Okay, simple fractures, sprains, minor lacerations. So last, black, unsalvageable. So not breathing and pulseless. So severely injured that no medical care is likely to help. So severe brain damage, extensive burns, major disruptions or loss of this chest or abdominal wall structures. Okay, this and all we are mostly these people will be seen in mortuary only. Okay. So this and all people will come under. So see, major disruption or loss of chest or abdominal wall structures. Okay, so this wall itself they have already gone, not the organs and all. Even if the major disruption, the wall of the abdominal structures also will come under black. Okay. So the concept of triage emerged from the French service, Desante, so that the resources could be used to the optimum, most for the most. Okay. Just remember the terms. And this, they have MCQs like they will ask for this symbol. Okay. So your first is your. So they ask for a symbol. What is for that zero? What is the symbol? And the one, what is the symbol? And second, it is tortoise and three is the ambulance. Okay. So like that, you remember the things. And here, you remember this terms also. So black means morgue, red means immediate, okay, yellow means delayed, and soon is black. Sorry, green. Minor is green. Green is that minor is your walking wounded. Okay. And the serious non-life threatening is comes under delayed yellow. Can life threatening injuries are red, and the pulse lessons are non-breathing under come under morgue. Okay. That how I have noted. Much is enough, I think. So then we'll go to the evacuation of the casualties. So the evacuation of the casualties, the important thing you have to notice, you should not do the second accident. Okay. That means that the paramedics accompanying the casualty should be resolved to prevent the second accident. The damage caused inadvertently by the transport and the treatment. Okay. The adequate supply of essentials such as IV fluids, dressing, pain medications, all things should be arranged. So next we'll come to the field hospitals. So field hospitals. So what are the things we are doing in the field hospital means? So before that, let's read the summary box. Essential for the casualty evacuation, so the directory is to upgrade priorities among the injured, select appropriate medical fields for transfer, choose appropriate means of transport, and prevent the second accident during transfer, and ensure an adequate supply of materials to accompany the patient. So let's remember the second accident. And in the field hospitals, what are the management you are doing in the field hospital is, that is the MCQ. So first aid, they are doing first aid, and second is the emergency care for the life-threatening injuries and initial care for the non-life-threatening injuries. Okay. So in first aid means what they are doing, like the examples like suturing person, laceration, splintage. So after that, they will review, ask the patient to come at the reviewing the local hospitals. Okay. That is a feature further to management. Okay. In the emergency care for the life-threatening injuries, what are things that are coming is your endotracheal intubation, tracheotomy, relieving tension in pneumothorax, stopping ischemic hemorrhage, relieving an EDH, okay, and emergency thoracotomy, laparotomy for internal hemorrhage. This will come under your emergency care for life-threatening injuries. Okay. So what is the further advice you will give that after damage control surgery, transfer the patient to the base hospitals once stable. Okay. And initial care for the non-life-threatening injuries, the other things. Okay, as example, debridement for the wounds, reduction of the fracture, application of external fixator, vascular repairs. So see your vascular repairs and all is coming under initial care for the non-life-threatening injuries. Okay, so that they will confuse. We'll say thought that the vascular repair is under life-threatening. It's actually non-life-threatening. Okay. So first, we are doing the first aid. After that, simply telling about the damage control surgery is a concept that only life and limb saving surgery be performed in the field hospitals. Okay, to allow safe transfer of the patient to a definitive treating facilities. So second, emergency care for the limited life threatening injuries. In that, they are telling that so damaged major vessels to limbs should be repaired if possible. Okay, so damaged major vessels to the limb should be repaired if possible. So fasciotomies will be needed for the muscle compartment that has swelling from injury or from repercussion. So amputation for the clearly devitalized limbs and gas gangrene should be undertaken at the field hospitals, as delay will be fatal. So these amputations and the damaged major vessel repair, everything will come under life-threatening injuries, emergency care for life-threatening injuries. This vascular repair is not a major vessel. Okay, just to note the word, the major vessel repair will come under life-threatening injuries, but this vascular repair will come under non-life-threatening injuries. So principles of the DCS, to do the minimum needed to allow safe transfer of a definitive facility, take action that prevent deterioration of the patient during transfer, secure the airway, may require tracheostomy, bleeding control, may require craniotomy, laparotomy, thoracotomy, and prevent pressure buildup, and prevent infection by extensional exposure and removing dead tissue under the condition. This and all comes under DCS. So your initial care for the non-life-threatening injuries, many patients sustain serious injuries that require primary care. So these include common limb fracture, degloving injuries, and dislocation of the major joints and major facial injuries and complex hand injuries. Okay. This patient will need specialized care, recurring transfer to the appropriate facilities. The MCQ is the replantation of the amputated limbs and other extensive procedure should not be attempted in the field hospitals. That you have to know. Okay, we will do amputation, but you should not do replantation. Okay, replantation, amputation, and other extensive procedures should not be attempted in field hospitals. Okay. So debridement. Debridement is also a French word. It's a meaning to unleash or cut to open. Yeah, here I'm only telling the MCQ points. Everything story only. So after administration of anesthesia, the injured area is copiously irrigated with the normal saline. So lavage using a pressurized system is controversial, with the concerns over the tissue trauma and the spread of the debris. Okay. So the wound is palpated and all foreign material removed. So dirt and debris enmeshed in soft tissue can only be removed by excision of those tissues. The open joint should be thoroughly irrigated and all foreign materials should be removed. No MCQ points actually. So here, suppose you're seeing a wound with extensive cavitation, should be enlarged longitudinally to assess the greater ashes. This could be carried out under a tourniquet because to prevent the bleedings. So you have to remove all dead and revitalized tissues. So muscle that is a pale or dark in color and does not contract and pinching and does not bleed and cutting must be removed. So what are the criteria to see to remove the tissue? That is muscle that is which is pale or dark in color and not contracting and not bleeding and cutting should be removed. Okay. So in the acute setting, only vascular repairs are justified. This is very important. So you should touch only the vessel. Okay, you should not touch the nerve and tendon. That is important. The vessel only should be vascular repair only is justified. Okay, for lacerated vessel, the ends are trimmed and an anastomosis should be performed. Okay, we can also do the venous bypass, reversible ingraft, silicon tubing. So as a for a temporary bypass, we can use it. But it nerves and tendons should not be dissected, but nor should any attempt to be made. Okay. So only we have to give a tag. Okay. So the edges are trimmed and tagged with the non-absorbable suture to facilitate repair during subsequent exploration. Okay. And the wound, how will you close this wound of this injury center? You should not close by primary closure. Okay. It's broad spectrum antibiotic needed. Yes. So prophylactic antibiotic needed. Yes. Prophylactically also antibiotic needed, and it should be continued for 5 to 7 days with the third generation cephalosporins. So when to re-inspect the wound? You are not doing primary repair. Okay. You are keep open only. Then when should we re-inspect the wound? Is at 24 to 48 hours you should re-inspect. Okay. And the wound is closed between fourth and sixth day you have to close the wound if there is no infection. Okay. And they are telling about the usage of the culture and the back closure and all. So once the wound free from the infection, secondary closure can be undertaken. So these are the principles of the initial wound care. In this MCQ is only the tag, tendons and nerves that have been cut. Okay. No need to repair this tendon and nerve. Okay. And avoid tight dressing and elevate the injured limb. So next year, a rule of thumb is that only half of the bed strength of the hospital can be utilized to provide optimum trauma care in an emergency situation. You should not use all the beds. Okay. Only half of the bed strength of the hospital can be utilized. So let's go to the limb salvage. The limb salvage, where we are using a score called mangled extremity severity score. Okay, so what is it contain? Hemant, what is MESS? What are the components of MESS?
That is what your mechanism of injury and your limb ischemia, shock and age, estimated age, shock, and your ischemia.
Yeah. Okay, very good. It contains injury, mechanism of injury, M, and E is for estimated ischemia, S is for shock, and this S is for seen age. Okay, so the score, if it comes more than 7 or more, you have to amputate. If the score is 6, less than 6, you have to do salvage. Okay, just remember, even Seviston. Okay, so more than 7, you have to amputate, and less than 6, you have to do salvage. So its modification are useful in deciding about limb salvage. Extensive tissue loss. Okay, so what they are including is, so mangled score is okay, and its modifications are useful in about limb salvage. They are using extensive tissue loss, neurovascular damage, and the loss of long fragments of the bone. Okay, are traditional indication for amputation. Okay. So this extensive tissue loss, neurovascular damage, and the loss of long fragments of bone also traditional indication for amputation. Currently, in the wound of any dimensions should be covered with the microvascular flap and destruction astrogenesis and vascularized bone can be used to restore any bony continuity. Okay, so because of this development, indication for amputation trauma have gone a paradigm shift, and this majority of the patients now reach a tertiary care facility within 24 hours are candidates are limb salvage. Okay, because of this many, this flaps, okay, and this long, because of this salvage procedures, we go within 24 hours, we can save the limb. Okay. So a limb is unlikely to survive if the vascular repair of the major limb vessel have been delayed for more than 4 to 6 hours. Okay. This is the 4 to 6 hours is very important. Then facial injuries. So facial injuries, even in who present late with the gross contamination, careful debridement followed by delayed primary closure can lead to good result. Okay. In the face, because the blood supply is very high. Okay. So even if you go late also, the gross contamination also, if you do careful contamination, the primary closure, it will be survived. Okay. You no need to give secondary closure and all in face. Okay. In even primary closure itself, the result will be good. The tetanus, is an important topic. The tetanus is a fatal condition known as lockjaw. It's caused by the Clostridium tetani, but it is a gram positive spore forming. It's okay. We know that the tetani is present in the soil, but here they're telling you it is naturally present in the intestine of humans also. Okay. So it comes enter into the body under anaerobic condition, and it's a toxin, is a tetanospasmin. This is exotoxin. Okay, exotoxin. Okay. So the median incubation period is 7 days. Okay, and ranging from 4 to 14 days. Okay, and yearly symptoms are painful spasm of the facial muscle. So what is the yearly symptom? MCQ. Okay, spasm of the facial muscle resulting in the risus sardonicus. Okay, the risus sardonicus is the painful spasm. Okay, of facial muscles. Okay, this is risus sardonicus. Okay, and the where the other things we will see is your opisthotonus, laryngeal muscle spasm. Okay, the spasm can be brought on by slightest of the sensory stimuli. Okay, how to prevent these manifestations? Okay, so mainly in tetanus there is a three aspect of management. One is prevention, and the second one is local wound care, and the third is supportive care. Okay, so first is the prevention. The wound contamination with the soil can harbor tetanus spores, and active initiation is indicated with administering TT injection. You have to give how much? 0.5 ml IM. So 0.5 ml TT you have to give for the contaminated wounds. Okay, so when to give this immunoglobulin? So when the patient with the gross contamination of cavitating wounds should receive 250 to 500 unit of immunoglobulins IM. Okay, to provide passive immunity and to neutralize the circulating toxin. So in fully blown clinical tetanus, a 3000 to 10000 unit of immunoglobulin. Okay, in the fully blown you have to give 3000 to 10000, but in gross contamination you have to give 250 to 500 unit of human anti tetanus. Okay, the various diagrams, this is your risus sardonicus of lockjaw. So after giving this ATG, you should not do wound manipulation for 2 to 3 hours after giving ATG. Okay, you should avoid wound manipulation 2 to 3 hours after ATG. Very important. Next, okay, why? Because to minimize the tetanus spasm release. So in the local wound care, how to do the local wound care means before that you have to give a penicillin G injection IV. Should be continued for 10 to 14 days. The dose is your 10 to 24, 10 power 6 unit per day. Okay. 10 to 24 units per day, penicillin G should be administered for 10 to 14 days. Okay. So the wound should be closed during the delayed primary or secondary closure techniques. You should close the wound with either delayed primary or secondary closure. The supportive care for the histopathic tissues, you should keep the patient in the ICU free from strong sensory stimuli. So what are the things you are using? Is diazepam. They are using especially to preventing the onset of spasm. Okay. And you have to intubate the patient if needed. And when you take the patient from the intubation, you have to give anticonvulsants. Okay, the overall mortality rate is about 45%. Okay, the overall mortality rate is about 45%. That's the number. So, what is the mortality rate for the gas gangrene? Necrotizing facilities.
16%.
20%. 70%.
Gas gangrene they gave or what?
No.
The necrotizing facility is 70%. Okay, this tetanus is 40%, necrotizing is 70%. And the tetanus, the summary box, they are giving the tetanus vaccine is an exotoxin. So there is no endotoxin, it's an exotoxin. Okay. And what is the prognostic factor? The prognosis is being determined by the incubation period and the time from the first symptom to the first tetanic spasm. Okay, in general, the shorter interval indicates poor prognosis. Okay, remember, shorter interval, remember poor prognosis. When you go to necrotizing facilities, it is a rapidly spreading infection that proceeds in necrosis of the subcutaneous tissue and the skin. Okay, the subcutaneous tissue and the skin. So, infected organisms are beta-hemolytic streptococci, occasionally scap aureus. Okay, but may take the form of polymicrobial infections. Okay, so most common infection is polymicrobial only, na? Specifically, they ask some.
Yes. Polymicrobial. But they will give you it is caused by Clostridium. That is a false statement.
Okay. Okay, then.
They gave mortality rates approaching more than.
Then everyone knows, I think.
Mortality rate more than
50% is established. Okay. So the fauna gangrene and the meninitis gangrene, everyone knows, I think. So the renal failure, it will lead to renal failure, may occur as a result of the hypovolemia and the cardiovascular collapse caused by the septic shock. Okay, the rate of progression is dramatic and unlessly aggressive. So the renal mortality rate is approaching 70%. Okay. Okay. So mainly the patient having renal failure, result of the hypovolemia, not result of the this myoglobinuria and all, myoglobin release and all, mainly because of the hypovolemia only the patient have releasing the renal failure. Okay, and cardiovascular collapse shock with a septic shock. So the diagnosis is made on clinical grounds. The creatine kinase levels may show enormous elevation, and the biopsy of the facial area will confirm the diagnosis. Okay. So my diagnosis mainly based clinical, and the confirmatory diagnosis is by your biopsy of the facial layer. Okay, not the skin, it's the facial layer. Okay, just remember everything is important. Okay, so facial layer you have to do the biopsy. So the patient should be admitted to the ICU, treated with the careful monitoring of the volume derangement. Okay, if needed, intubation is needed, you have to give. So what is the drug of choice? Is your high dose penicillin G. Okay. With a broad spectrum antibiotics such as paracetamol, cephalosporins with the metronidazole. So three things they are using. Okay. So penicillin G, high dose penicillin G, paracetamol, cephalosporins and the metronidazole. So given IV. So the cornerstone of the management is surgical excision of necrotic tissue. So if the deviated tissue is removed generationally, going beyond the area of duration. Okay. The wound is lightly plaqued with the gauze and dressed. So this process is repeated daily. So this debridement and excision of the necrotic tissue and all you have to do daily. Okay. So let's look into it. These are the necrotizing facilities. Okay. So they will confuse this with the pressure source and all. Just to remove this. Let's see, this is a necrotizing facilities. So the progress is rapid and renal failure is an yearly complication. So treat with the radical surgical incision. It should be repeated every 24 hours. Give oxygen and penicillin. So what is the role of hyperbaric oxygen? Okay, in reducing the mortality in patient treated with the HBO 90 to 20 compared with the patient who did not receive the HBO. Okay, so previously the told that the mortality rate of 70%. If the patient is treated with the HBO, they reduce the mortality by 9 to 20%. This is important MCQ. Okay. Just remember, then you go to the gas gangrene. So gas gangrene is a rapidly progressive, potentially fatal condition. Okay. So characterized by widespread necrosis of the muscle and the soft tissue destruction. Okay. It's mainly dealing with the muscle and the soft tissue destruction. So where is the cellulitis? What is the cellulitis? Definition of cellulitis.
Spreading. Myofascial.
Subcutaneous or fascia. Which layer it will affect?
Subcutaneous
also, and it's the facial layer also.
My facial.
Okay. And this gas gangrene affect your muscle and soft tissue destruction. So the common causative organism is Clostridium difficile is for spore forming gram positive saprophyte. Okay. That flourishes in the anaerobic condition. The other organism in other Clostridium organisms are, you can remember as BCS. Okay. So bifermentants, BSS. Septicum sporangens. Okay, so bifermentants, septicum sporangens. Okay, and the Clostridium perfringens. Everything come into the Clostridium group. And what is the percentage of non-clostridial gas-producing organisms? Okay, we associated with the gas gangrene is 60 to 85%. The 60 to 85% is associated with the non-clostridial gas-producing organisms. So the Clostridium perfringens mainly producing exotoxin. Mainly three type of toxins. They divide into three type of toxins. One is alpha, pi. And the gamma toxins, okay, very, very important. Among these, the most important toxin is alpha toxin. And it's a lecithinase. Okay, because it's lecithinase, it destroys RBC, WBC, plated fibroblast and muscle cells. Just remember, all are important MCQ points. So RBC, WBC, platelet, fibroblast and muscle cells will be destroyed by your alpha toxin, which produces lecithinase. And your five toxins produces myocardial suppression. Okay, and the gamma toxin for the destruction of the connective tissue and fibrosis. Okay, so myocardial by pi. And the connective tissue and the blood vessels by kappa. Okay. First, go through it once. And the usual incubation period is less than 24 hours. What is the incubation period for tetanus?
4 to 14 days, 7 days.
7 days. Here is less than 24 hours only, but ranges from 1 hour to 6 weeks. 1 hour to 6 weeks, less than 24 hours. That is our incubation period. Okay. Then, what is the earliest symptom in tetanus?
Rhesus tonicus, painful
scalp of the muscle. Yeah, here the ALS symptom is pain that rapidly increases in severity. Okay. So that is the ALS symptom in gas gangrene. Okay. And the characteristic sickly, what is they are telling that? So the characteristic sickly sweet odor and the soft tissue crepitus appear with the established infection, but their absence does not exclude the diagnosis. Very, very important. Okay, it will be present in the established infection, but the absence also didn't exclude the diagnosis. Okay. Hey, Rishikesh, if I'm missing any point, just tell me, man.
No, no, you are telling everything.
If I miss any point, you just inform. Okay. And then the diagnosis is mainly based on the your clinical diagnosis. Your tetanus is based on clinical, but here it is based on history and the clinical features. Okay. Then the peripheral smear shows hemolysis. Gram stain of the X-ray reveal gram positive SLA without neutrophils. Okay, that's very important. So gram stain will show gram positive SLA without neutrophils, and the PBS shows hemolysis. Okay, and the myochemical profile will show metabolic acidosis and a renal failure. Okay, and the radiographic and visualize the gas in the soft tissues is particularly useful in patient with the chest and abdominal involvement. Okay, so ICU treatment, what is it? Here also they are giving penicillin G and clindamycin. They are using clindamycin with detergent cephalosporin. They are not using metronidazole and necrotizing this gas gangrene in comparing with that. Okay. The gas gangrene, they are not using this this one. And the surgical management, just see here, penicillin G plus clinda plus detergent cephalosporin. Okay. In established gas gangrene with a systemic toxicity, amputation of the involved extremities is life-saving and should not be delayed. General fact only. So no attempt is made at closure, and amputation steps should be left open. Very, very important. You should not be close the amputation steps. Okay. And any role of hyperbaric oxygen here, okay, is not as clear as in necrotizing case it is, but it is recommended in severe cases in where the facility is available. Okay. Your necrotizing case it is only your hyperbaric oxygen will be needed. Whereas it is the mortality rate to how much percentage?
Nine to 20.
So these three are very important: tetanus, necrotizing fasciitis, and this gas gangrene. Yeah. So then we go to the Crassigerian syndrome. So the Crassigerian syndrome, what you have to know is. So the association between the crushing injury and the rhabdomyolysis acute kidney injury was first reported in victims trapped during London Blitz. Okay. So in this scene in the earthquake minimal accident that like there is there, the what is the pathophysiology behind this crushing of metal? The prolonged crushing of the muscles lead to reperfusion injury when the casualty is rescued. This releases myoglobin and vasoactive mediators in the circulation. This myoglobinuria will cause the renal failure because of the tubular obstruction. Okay. This renal failure is very important. You should avoid this renal failure so that you have to dealing with the myoglobinuria. You have to prevent the myoglobinuria. Okay. For that, you have to give rapid resuscitation. Okay. So the treatment of crushing casualties, this is very, very important MCQ, that when you should treat the crushing casualties, you should begin as soon as they are discovered. It's not in the hospital. As soon as you see the crushing casualties, the treatment you should begin the treatment. Okay. The rescuers must alert to the presence of the associated injuries and associate aggressive volume loading of patients, preferably before extrication. Okay, yes, before extrication is the best treatment. So you should do the treatment before extrication itself. So what you have to do, you have to give saline infusion of 1 to 1.5 liter per hour. See, per hour you have to give 1 to 1.5 liter. Okay, and this should be continued until myoglobin is longer detectable in the urine. So next to water problem to give to prevent the mitral, to prevent the myoglobin by ACE, you have to give mitral initiation. It can reduce the reperfusion component of this injury. Okay, so you have to give saline infusion, mitral, and once the flow of urine is observed, a mitral alkaline diuresis. Then only you have to give diuresis. Okay, initially you should not give diuresis. Okay, the mitral alkaline diuresis you should give when the flow of urine is observed. Before that, you should not give this diuresis. Okay, up to 8 liters per day. So how they are giving mitral alkaline diuresis, up to 8 liters per day should be maintained and keeping the urinary pH greater than 6.5. So every word is MCQ. So saline infusion, 1 to 1.5 liter per hour. Okay, next to mitral, next to mitral alkaline diuresis, 8 liters per day. Okay, and keep the urinary pH greater than 6.5. Okay, so in the late fasciotomy, you should avoid the late fasciotomy. Because why? Because the late fasciotomy will cause the massive release of myoglobin into the blood. So that they are telling that it is therefore best not to perform the fasciotomy in cases where entrapment has been over 12 hours. Okay, all numericals are very important in this chapter. Here also they are insisting that the late fasciotomy makes things worse, not better. So compartment syndrome. The compartment syndrome. So not that much they have given. They are given the passive stretching of the affected muscle will cause extreme pain. That is the diagnostic of this condition. Okay. So it is also clinically diagnosed only the compartment syndrome.
What is the most common cause of compartment syndrome? Soft tissue injury, fractures, cast. What is that? Coagulopathy.
Fracture.
How much percentage?
I don't know, bro.
70%. Page 408.
Fracture 70%, soft tissue 23%. So fracture is the most
50%. Common. Okay. In that, what is the yearly sign in compartment syndrome? Yearliest sign.
Pain in passive stretching of the muscles.
What is the late sign? Very good. What is the late sign?
Pulselessness.
Paresthesia and pulselessness.
Paresthesia and pulselessness. Okay. Okay. Sir, then we'll ask, when will you do, what is the indication for fasciotomy?
When in doubt, you go for fasciotomy. When you do pressure studies or...
What is the compartment pressure? More than
30
mm.
Also, difference between the diastole pressure and compartment pressure also, if it is more than 30, again you have to go. There are 30 in 230 are there. One is compartment absolute compartment pressure. One is the difference between diastolic blood pressure and
compartment pressure.
Compartment pressure and diastolic pressure, that also you have to do. More than
30. That is called as compartment gradient. Whenever compartment gradient, what you told, diastolic minus system, diastolic pressure minus compartment pressure, it should be, if it is less than 35, then you have to go for compartment fasciotomy. If the normal compartment
30,
pressure
30,
is more
not
than
35.
No, this compartment gradient.
Not 35, 30. Compartment gradient also 30 only, it is given in Bailey.
30.
Is it?
That is also okay. 30 only, given in Bailey.
Can compartment syndrome occur in open fractures?
It can occur.
But at the remote site.
Well,
not at the site of the open fracture.
Okay.
It will not, at the site of the open fracture, it will not occur. It is given in, they can occur with an open injury if the wound does not extend to the affected compartment.
Okay.
Page 28.
Okay. What they have given?
They told compartment syndrome can occur with an open injury if the wound does not extend into the affected compartment.
Okay. So, which degree of burn will cause a compartment syndrome?
Third degree circumferential.
Yes, very good. This also given 408 pages, very important. Let's go through it. And the other, this are the one first indication, more than 30. Second indication is less than 30 for the gradient pressure. And another one is whenever clinical signs is present, you have to go for fasciotomy. And number fourth is when you have ischemia more than 6 hours. Okay, just remember these four things for indication for the fasciotomy. So how to identify the compartment pressure? What catheter you will use? It is called a Stryker needle catheter.
Stryker is actually a company.
Stryker.
He is a company actually. It is given in the sacristan. The figure is there. It is a company actually.
Company only.
They have made one. You read it in sabistan, no, Prem?
Yes. And the pressure studies, you know, notes also they given. This same thing. I are reading notes. Then they give one word. Okay, the pressure studies are not reliable. And if it in doubt, perform a fasciotomy. That also indication for fasciotomy. Okay. So, the compartment syndrome is the commonest in the closed loop fracture or soft tissue stress injury. The pain and the passive extension of the muscle
diagnostic. Means compartment syndrome. What is the late complication of, means what is the sequelae of compartment syndrome?
What, bro, I don't know.
Volcanic ischemic contracture.
VIC. You missed it. Fourth line, last fourth line. Yes, yes.
Okay, that is your late complication.
Okay, late complication.
Okay, okay. Okay, then if there is intracompartmental presence studies are not reliable, if there is any suspicion, then facial reading must be performed. Okay, then what is frostbite? What is immersion injuries? The frostbite occurs when a part of the body freezes. Okay, these cells are distributed and the cell dies. Okay. There is a difference between the frostbite and the immersion injury. The frostbite depicts where whenever body freezes, it indicates frostbite. Okay, whenever immersion injury, what is immersion injury means? It is a cold injury which does not involve actual freezing of the tissue and is commonly caused by the prolonged immersion in cold water. Okay, so immersion means not a freezing of the body. It is mean that a prolonged immersion in cold water, otherwise called trench foot. So both are different entities. So frostbite and immersion injuries. Okay, so what is the mechanism behind the frostbite? Is a vasoconstriction. Okay, by the cold and the capillary sludging and the refurbishment injury with the release of the free radicals. Okay, which occurs on rewarming the part. Okay, that is a mechanism. Okay. So it commonly involves finger, toes, cheek, and the tip of the nose and the ears. Okay, mainly on the surrounding the face and fingers and the toes. Okay. So one more important point is when the tissue will be frozen, it feels hard and it cannot be indented. These are the features of frostbite. So immersion injury is a cold injury which does not involve actual freezing and is commonly caused by the prolonged immersion. That is called hence trench foot. The patient may also be hypothermic. So this is very important. Many times they have asked this question. So warming should be gentle as the heat used to may actually cause a burn. Okay, so gentle warming, that word is very important.
In burn chapter, they are saying rapid rewarming in a bath at 42 degrees centigrade.
For?
Controversy.
Okay. 42 degrees centigrade temperature. They also gave French foot or what? French foot like that or what? Frostbite. So, okay. So then you have to give NSAIDs like ibuprofen are beneficial and you should wait for the demarcation line to occur. Until then, you should not do surgery. That is a funda in this frostbite management and all. You should wait for the demarcation line to present. Okay. So, that injured the area should be kept clean and dry and the efforts made to prevent further injuries as well prevent infection. But definitely surgery to excise the dead tissue can be left for many months. Okay. So, the definitive surgery to excise the dead tissue can be left for many months. Just note the word. Okay. Here it is different. Okay. Trench foot. Okay. And the recent development such as use of TPA nerve blocks. This also they can ask once. Okay. So what is the recent developments in the management of the trench foot? Using of TPA nerve blocks so promising results in reducing amputation. Okay. But you have started within 24 hours. That is very important. Okay. You should start this TPA nerve blocks under within 24 hours and are seldom positive in the field. Okay. So summary box, frostbite can be superficial, deep like a burn. It's rewarm gently and allow demarcation to occur naturally in the product against further trauma or infection. So follow up on the secondary problems. Is that they're telling that there are, it's not only if you're treating the patient in the field itself, field or hospitals, we have to follow the patient. That means that the second wave of patient is encountered 3 to 6 months following a major catastrophe and our rearrangement should be made to deal with this. Okay, so 3 to 6 months, you have to remember this number. So they will ask, then disaster planning. So disaster planning, including four things actually. Okay, that is what they can ask. So what you have to do is planning is the establishment of a national disaster management organization. Okay. So this is, and the second thing is anticipating disasters and the evacuation planning. Okay, and the organization of emergency services. These are the four you have to remember for disaster planning. Okay, and summary box, what they gave is disaster planning is disaster can be anticipated and should be prepared for. Next, evacuation. Anticipation, evacuation of whole population may be a best option. This is the best option. Disaster planning is evacuation of the whole population. Okay, and coordination between the military, police, and fire ambulance. That coordination also needed. So, in that, what is the first step in planning for disaster? This MCQ. Okay, the first step in planning for disaster is the establishment of a national disaster management organization. Okay. It's the first step. I have told another one first step, na initial.
coordination.
Assessment. Assessment is the first step.
No, no, it's assessment. The first objective.
First objective is this one, assessment.
Okay.
Damage assessment is the first objective.
Assessment.
First, it is to prevent the damage. First, this one objective is a disaster management is your assessment of the damage. And first priority in rescue operation is preventing further damage. That's why you told first.
So anticipating disasters. So you have to anticipate. Okay. So before disaster, we have to anticipate based upon the areas. Okay. There are stories only. So evacuation planning. You should know what is the clear identification of the exit routes must be determined and communicated to the population at risk. That is evacuation planning and organization of emergency services like fire brigade, police, ambulance service must have been also defined roles. So these are the things. Then medical planning. I'll take today or tomorrow. I will finish now itself. Okay, I will go. I didn't read much well, but I will tell the important points, MCQ points only. So in conflict surgery, so what you have to know about in conflict surgery means. So first you have to know this word. Who wishes to be a surgeon must first go to a war. It was told by the Hippocrates. Okay, it was quoted by the Hippocrates. That is very important. Then, ethical and legal consideration. So, which law regulates the humanitarian issues during armed conflicts? That's IHL, the MCQ. Okay. Okay, this IHL, international humanitarian law only regulates this armed conflicts and all. So, this is IHL, but the modern IHL is derived from the variety of sources like Geneva Conventions. Okay. And its additional protocols, along with the other specific regulations from the UN and the Hague. Okay, not need.
No, there are name. Some name. Names are there. Important actually. Edwin Smith Papares, oldest to treat the trauma surgery, and Dominic Jean Larre, first modern military surgeon. And Larre's first system of triage and casualty care. And Rotondo et al. Was the people who invented DCS.
Only this chapter name is important or what? Like this, every chapter 10 names are there.
No, this chapter there are
But this Larre is important, I think. I also this triage system.
Larre somewhere I heard actually.
Larre also in triage is there.
Larre.
Okay. So anything in this, always war surgery is different, right? I don't find it in MCQ. Okay. So, one thing they have told is anything important?
No, continue whatever you tell. Okay. It's important.
Then ethical and legal consideration, the IHL, you have to know about this IHL term. And this is importantly, medical professionals are bounded by a medical ethics and IHL to treat the patient solely based upon the need and without regard for the nationality. You should treat the patient with this war persons without knowing their nationality, race, class, religious or political beliefs. Okay, this is very important. And you should treat both home nation people also under the enemy combatants also. Both the combatants also you have to treat. Okay. And next to the transfer to host nation medical facilities may be possible, but dependent on local capability. So medical professional and facilities are protected under IHL and they should not be attacked. This they can ask which law they are protected means under IHL only. So medical support and role is very important. The term role is used to designate the tiers of medical support and integrate into a modern military operation. So everything given the summary box, there are four roles are there, role 1, role 2, role 3. So role 1 is a unit level medical care including first aid and PSC. Okay, second is intermediate unit. Okay, where they will do resuscitation, damage control and stabilization. So role 3 is your deployed hospitals. Okay, care with multi-specialty capability. And role 4 is a definitive hospital. Okay. Care within the home or allied nation. Okay. So deployed hospital care is R3 and the definitive hospital is R4. Okay. Next, medical evacuation. So, with the medical evacuation, there should be settled. Usually, you'll do aeromedical evacuation only. Okay, using either fixed or rotatory wing aircrafts. Okay, but a certain consultation you should make before doing this. In that, the main MCQ is you should do a prophylactic chest tube placement before prolonged aeromedical evacuation. So, rest and all already known only. So, it is a different point. Okay, you should do chest tube placement before prolonged aeromedical evacuation in case of patient who is having high risk of thoracic barotrauma. Okay, should be considered. So, patterns of modern war surgery. So, historically, the predominance, so which is the most common mode of wound is, historically, the predominance of penetrating trauma was sustained by combat infantry, while the naval and air personnel sustained more blunt injuries. That is before. Okay. That they are given here also. So, this table, they are given that, just to see, so ballistics injuries and all more commonly encountered by infantry people and armored people. Okay. Wherever the naval people is more prone for thermal injuries. And these are Air Force people and all will be having blunt injuries. Okay, blunt injuries will be the more in this Air Force people. Then, and I have found one word, the head and neck injuries are more, where which part of the injury is more common? It's head and neck injuries. It's more common in the recent conflicts. Okay. So, while the thoracic and extremity injuries are well less so, this is probably due to the increased use of body armors and similar personal protective equipments. Okay. So, while ballistic injuries remain an important contributor to battlefield trauma, injuries to the explosions, which is the explosion which includes the IED, landmine, mortars, many things are there, have become increasingly common. So, now the battlefield trauma injuries to the explosions are very common. Okay. The emergence of explosive pattern injuries due to increasing use of IEDs within the conflict. Any more MCQ, Hemant?
No.
So, principles of war surgery. So, principles of war surgery, the battlefield death mainly due to two things. One is early or immediately and late. Okay. So, death occurs early or immediately because of CNS injury or hemorrhage. Okay. And late due to infection. Very important. So, early CNS injury or hemorrhage, late due to infections. Okay. So they're giving one term, some of the injuries causing immediate death, including brain, heart, greater than injury, are non-survivable and may only be managed with the prevention. Okay. So next, this table is telling that relative proportion of injuries caused by the gunshot wound and explosions. Okay, in that this gunshot wound is very high compared to explosions. Okay.
No, so, they are telling based on the war. Matlab, recently gunshot wound injuries are decreasing actually. Yeah, exposure is increasing. That is what you have to tell. Like Iraq and Afghanistan and all recent, no, US Civil War, World War One and all, before gunshot was more. Now explosion is more. That's what they tell.
So then the treatment of hemorrhage is therefore, what is the mainstay of mainstay of management in military trauma is? The treatment of hemorrhage. Okay, MCQ. Treatment of hemorrhage is there. Therefore, the mainstay of military trauma medicine. And regarding the management of the bleeding, non-compressible torso hemorrhage carries a poor prognosis. Okay. So, non-compressible torso hemorrhage carries a poor prognosis, although it may be amenable to methods of endovascular control not yet commonly used. Okay, next, damage control surgery. The damage control surgery was first described by Rotondo. Very important. So, Rotondo et al. Described the first damage control surgery. So, damage control surgery is approached to preserve the physiology over anatomy. Okay. And it's typically divided into several phases. Daily, there are being four phases. Okay. What we heard here is stages means five. Okay. Where you seen previously. But phases mean four. Okay. The fourth phase, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. So, one is for recognition of injury. Okay. And two is for immediate laparotomy. And three is for management ICU. And four is for definitive care management. So in the first phase only, we are doing a rapid sequence injection of anesthesia, RSI, and early rewarming, the prompt movement to the operation theater. So everything will continue in the first phase. Okay. So next to DCR. So DCR should be encountered, it should be concurrent with the DCS. It's not a separate thing. It should be concurrent with the DCS. The principle of DCR is very important in MCQ. It indicates a permissive hypotension, avoidance of crystallite with the hemostatic resuscitation and the recognition and the management of acute traumatic coagulopathy, ATC. So three things that insisting in this DCR is one is hypotension and avoidance of crystalloid. Okay, and another one is a recognition and management of coagulopathy. Okay, so hypotension, crystalloid, coagulopathy, you have to remember. That is a thing they are telling in this DCR, principles of DCR, very important MCQ. So next, massive transmission, no MCQ. Anything, Hemant?
The use of crystalloids to resuscitate exsanguinating patient is strongly discouraged, but the optimal use of blood products has not been yet ascertained. Something like that I marked.
Decision making with the deployed environments, they are telling that one word within a well established role 3 unit. Okay, in the role 3 unit, both DCS and definitive procedures are likely to be possible. Okay, so what is role 3?
Deployed
hospital is multi-specialty. Okay. Multi-specialty care. There only your DCS and definitive procedures are likely to be possible. That is very important. Okay. This line they can ask. And in context of the decision making becomes more crucial within atmospheric environment. The theater space, ICU beds, equipment, blood product may be limited. So long evacuation time may contraindicate permissive hypotension. So the evacuation time should be very short. You should not make a long evacuation time. So evacuation time is very long, your permissive hypotension it may contraindicate. Okay. So that way telling, so limited sources such as blood and manure to be given. Hello?
Yes. In permissive hypotension, what should be the blood pressure to be maintained?
It should be maintained less than 100 or what?
70 to 90.
70 to 90.
More than 90 is less than 90, I guess. 90 to more than 90 is for 80 degree. And tranexamic acid should be given within how many hours?
What?
Tranexamic acid should be given how many hours?
8 hours.
No, first dose.
First dose will be 10 minutes.
1 gram should be given stat.
Three years. Okay, continue.
Okay. So now should go to the weapon methods. What we have told us here, I found one thing: the limited resources such as blood may need to be divided between the casualties within a role 1 or role 2 facility. The immediate evacuation may be undertaken in performance to a more thorough stabilization. Okay. Found the weapon effects. Compared to the ballistics. So ballistics, you have to the three ballistic types are there: internal ballistic, external ballistic, and thermal ballistics. Summary was 31.2. The internal ballistic characterizes a projectile within your weapon during firing. External ballistics characterizes a projectile in the free flight, and thermal ballistics characterizes a projectile at tissue interaction. Okay. First, let's say about internal ballistics. So the internal ballistics, there is not much MCQs related to medical terms. Okay. Anything, Hemant? So just to remember that.
Rifles are. Prem. Rifles are expected to be accurate at ranges up to and beyond 1,000 meters.
Yeah, that I am telling. But the external ballistics, no? That will come under external ballistics. So in the internal ballistics, you see just a shotgun. Okay, shotgun utilizes a similar mechanism except that the collection of a smaller projectiles and the shot are expelled rather than a single bullet. So usually they are using the two types of methods are there. In semi-automatic or fully automated systems and all, a bullet will come. But in case of shotguns, okay, they mainly pellets will come. That's what they are telling. And the external ballistics describe the characteristics of projection in the free flight. Okay, in that there is a difference between the pistol and the rifle. You have to know what is the difference between the pistol and rifle. In this, a rifle are expected to accurate at a range up to 1 kilometer. Okay, whereas the pistols are intended to for shorter ranges. And the rifle cartridges are longer. Okay, and typically have a greater proportion of propellant to project. Okay. And the characteristics of ammunition. What is ammunition? Ammunition is gunpowder. Okay, that determines the wound effect or the sizes and the caliber. Size and the caliber only determine the wound effect. Okay. And the size or caliber, and the second one is the material component of the bullet. Okay. So what is determining the wound effect means the size or caliber, and the second one is the material component of the bullet. Okay.
Ammunition is at
Hello?
Ammunition is a metal part.
Metal part or what?
Surrounding that metal, bullet ammunition is this metal, it is fully loaded with projectile and parts.
Okay. Search in the Google only. So suppose a fully metal jacket ammunition as an outer coating of hard metal and around a shaft core, this reduces the breakdown of the bullet along the barrel and it improves the accuracy, reliability, and the target penetration. Okay. So your penetration will be target penetration will be more in case of full metal jacket ammunitions. Okay. Accuracy will be more in case of full metal jacket ammunition, whereas your soft tip and hollow point ammunitions have a degree of exposed leads that flattens and deforms an impact. In that, what will happen is the bullets have less penetrating ability. Okay, and they rapidly rapidly transfer energy to the impacted tissue and causes large wounds. So your soft tissue hollow point ammunitions will cause large wounds, where your full metal jacket ammunitions will cause target penetration. Okay, that is a keyword here. Okay. So in the ballistics injuries, the terminal ballistics, otherwise called wound ballistics, they will ask what wound ballistics or terminal ballistics are the same only. Okay, it characteristics the projectile and tissue in the tissue interaction, projectile or tissue interaction, that is important. That is, this ballistics injury is very important for the medicos. Okay, to describe the interaction between the projectile and the target tissues. Okay, in that actually two cavities will be formed. One is permanent cavity and is a temporary cavity. Okay, in that the permanent cavity will be formed even in the low energy weapon, and which will cause this temporary cavity by typical of high energy weapon. The high energy weapon only will cause a temporary cavity. Okay. So we are telling that the permanent cavity is the localized area of definitely tissue injury caused by the contact with the projectile. The size and the trajectory of the projectile determines the cavity size. Okay. Which determines the cavity size? Size and the trajectory of the projectile determines the cavity size. So next point is very important. This type of cavity is a predominant wound effect of pistol bullets, but that have a relatively low energy. The relatively low pistol only, it will cause the permanent cavity. Okay. The high energy projectiles, including military rifle and machine gun bullets, okay, may subject to a greater degree of deformation and tumbling as they travel through the tissue. Okay, because of this only the temporary cavities are forming, because of larger only. So whenever this high energy things like your military rifles and machine gun bullets, this and all will cause increases the cross-section area of the projectile and may lead to a larger and a less regular permanent wound cavity. Okay. So the wound cavity, just telling about the permanent cavity. The permanent cavity, okay. So if the cavity is larger and less regular, it indicates that the energy is very high because of the military rifle or machine gun bullet. So in contrast, the temporary wound cavity is created by a lateral displacement of the tissue that has not been in direct contact with the bullet. Okay. So the degree of damage in this area is dependent on, very, very important, amount of energy transferred by the bullet and the material properties of the tissue. So one is both bullet and the tissue is responsible for this temporary cavity. What is in that bullet means your amount of energy transferred by the bullet and the material properties of the tissue. Both are very important. So suppose the tissues with the good elastic strength, like the skin, muscle, lung, bowel wall, okay, and all may rebound well following stretch, okay, with the minimal damage within the temporary wound cavity. But your liver, brain, and spleen have and all poor elasticity, and they are more likely to shatter when stretched. Okay. So these are the organs. These three organs, liver, brain, spleen, and all, used to be shattered. Okay. Okay, and the incompressibility of the fluid within the hollow organs, bowel, bladder, means that they are vulnerable to stretch despite favorable properties of the tissue wall itself. Okay. So just note these two things. Okay. where the tissue with the good elastic strength or the tissue with the poor elastic strength. So next, management of the gunshot wound. The management of the gunshot wound is, of course, a normal low energy wound like pistol and all, we manage conservatively only. Okay. If the higher energies will be managed by the higher energy will be managed with care, especially you have to do you have to see the size of the wound cavity mainly. Okay. So the higher energy wound is always associated with higher rate of infections. So you have to see the size of the wound cavity may not be adequately assessed without thorough surgical examination. Okay. So how to assess this wound cavity and all? The most penetrating wound in the military setting are explored under anesthesia only. You should not do normally. The anesthesia only you have to do wound exploration. Okay. Because this is self-estimating only. Because outside what you are seeing is very less, but inside it the cavity will be very large. So in anesthesia, with anesthesia only you have to do these things and all. Okay, so what the extent under the cavity for recovery of the temporary wound cavity may not be appreciated at the time of the first operation. Okay, and another fact is an interval period may also allow for adequate appreciation of the permanent wound cavity along with the response to the surrounding structures and the demarcation of the non-healed tissue. So an interval period may be needed. Okay, so next we'll go to the blast. So in the blast, what is explosive? That is a very important definition. Is there a substance that can be made to undergo a rapid chemical reaction that will transform a liquid, okay, or solid into gas? Okay, that is very important. Liberating the large amount of energies. Okay, what is the low explosives? The low explosive react by a process called deflagration. Okay, this they can ask. That true or false statement they can ask. Okay, the low explosives react by a process called deflagration, whereby the reaction is propagated by a flame passing through the material at a rate significantly slower than the speed of the sound. Okay, so that the flame will pass slower than the speed of the sound. Okay. So they are made of combustible materials like an accompanying oxidant. So lowest, what are the examples for the low explosives? For gunpowder, gasoline, and the pyrotechnics, such as the water using fireworks. Okay, this is the slow point. Slow rate is very important. So it is slower than the speed of the sound. Okay, the flame.
Okay. Bombs.
And the low explosives are commonly caused bombs. Very important. Then typical burst injuries, and it will not be discussed further. Okay, this low explosives are commonly caused bombs. That you remember. And in contrast, high explosive, B grade via detonation. Where low grade, what is a low grade? Low grade, how it is reacting by a process of CGS. Hello.
Bolo.
So low grade explosives. No. How is the low-grade explosives working, reacting? What is the process for the low-grade explosives?
Deflagration.
The word you have to remember. So low-grade explosives is react by a process called deflagration. But the high explosives by detonation. Okay. The deflagration, detonation you have to remember. Okay. So the shock waves are passing through the material at a supersonic speed. Okay, just remember. If where in the low explosives, it will be slower than the sound. But here you see this shock waves are going in the supersonic speeds and the resultant energy is expelled at a very high rates. So example for the high explosive rates are your plastic explosives and the TNT. Okay, the TNT and the plastic explosives are examples. So they're telling that, then they're explaining this curve. This curve, it is a expected MCQ. Okay. So what is the name of this curve? Hemant? Yes, there are.
But you can't do it.
Sorry, okay. So this is your Friedlander curve. Okay. This curve is called a Friedlander curve. So here they're telling that two words, you have to know about two words. Blast, what is blast over pressure and what is near instantaneous pressure rise? Okay. So here x-axis you take the time and y-axis you take the pressure. So whenever blast is happening, okay, if the time is going on, you will reach a high time. That is, first you will this curve, what is initial rising is your instantaneous pressure rise. That is called the quasi instantaneous pressure rise, and it will reach to a height. Okay, that is called the blast over pressure. Okay. So the blast over pressure, it indicates your changes in the surrounding pressure. This is your surrounding pressure actually. How is the after blast? How is the surrounding pressure will be there? It will indicate by the blast pressure. Okay, after the blast pressure reaches height, it will again start to come at a positive pressure phase. That will come to a negative pressure phase. Then it will reaches the atmospheric pressure phase. So these are the overall pressure changes happening after a blast injury in the free field. Okay, so first your quasi instantaneous pressure will be there. Okay, so quasi instantaneous pressure, after that blast over pressure, after that positive pressure phase, negative pressure phase, then atmospheric pressure phase. So this is the sequence. Okay, after a blast injury. Okay, so this curve is your Friedlander curve. So the changes in the surrounding tissue surrounding pressure is described as a blast over pressure, and the following detonation within a free field, there is a near instantaneous pressure rise which falls exponentially, and this is classically described with the Friedlander curve. Okay, so then they are telling on fact that for this reason, a blast within a enclosed space are notable for causing a greater range and severity of injury. Okay, so they gave the pathophysiology, why in the closed space this is very high. Okay, just read if you want. Okay, so the final thing is, so blast within the enclosed space are causing a greater range and severity of the injury. Okay, so these are the things we are done. They are telling about one thing, IED, improvised explosive devices. So the characteristic weapon of a modern warfare have been IED, which has a leading cause of death. Okay, it is a leading of the death among the coalition troops in Iraq and African. So within this broad range of device, our further categories include roadside explosives and the blast mines, suicide bombers, and explosive formed projectiles, EFP. Okay, these are the categories under IED. Okay, so EFP are a particular form of device, okay, with a deformable plate on the uppermost surface. It's not known it actually. Okay, we'll leave this topic. Just to know, IED is the leading cause of death amongst coalition troops, okay, in Iraq and Afghanistan. And subcategories of these IEDs are roadside explosions, blast mines, suicide bombers, all come under IED only. Okay. Apart from that, I think no other MCQ in the IED. So next we'll go to the blast injuries. This table is very important. Classification of blast injury, primary, secondary, tertiary, quaternary, quaternary. So primary is you have to know the injury types and examples also. The primary only because of the overpressure. Okay. And the most common organ injuries are tympanic membrane. Okay. Tympanic membrane is very important in primary blast. The most common primary blast injury. They will ask two questions actually in the primary blast. What is the most common primary blast injury? The most common primary blast injury is your tympanic membrane rupture. Okay, then the another thing is, so what is the most widely researched blast phenomenon? Okay, primary blast injury, primary blast lung injury, or the blast lung is the most widely researched blast phenomenon. Okay, you have to know the two different words. Most common is a tympanic membrane rupture, and most widely researched blast phenomenon is primary blast lung injury. Okay. So in that, so these are the MCQs. Then they will ask what is the mechanism behind this primary blast lung injury. The three mechanisms. One is swelling, okay, and another one is implosions, and third one is rapid acceleration of the tissues, different densities. It is not a deceleration. I saw an MCQ based on this. Okay, these are three mechanisms. One is swelling, another one is implosion, and third one is a rapid acceleration or the deceleration. So what is swelling means? The disruption of tissues at the liquid air liquid interfaces, and the implosions is a compression and the re-expansion of the air filled structures. Okay, these are the physics words. Just remember, just mark it up. Okay, swelling, implosion, and the rapid acceleration. Okay, and the level of injury is related to the rate of chest wall displacement rather than the maximum depth of deflections. Okay, and the severity of injury. The level of injury is related to the chest wall displacement, okay, rather than the maximal depth of deflection. Okay, அந்த சிவியாரிட்டி ஆஃப் தி இன்ஜுரி டெபெண்டன்ட் ஆன் ஸ்ட்ரென்த் ஆஃப் பிளாஸ்ட் ரேஞ்ச் ஃப்ரம் த டீடோனேஷன் அண்ட் சரௌண்டிங் என்விரான்மெண்ட். ஓகே, திஸ் இஸ் வெரி இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். தே வில் ஆஸ்க் திஸ் க்வெஸ்சன். ஓகே, சிவியாரிட்டி ஆஃப் தி இன்ஜுரி இஸ் டெபெண்டன்ட் ஆன் நம்பர் ஒன் ஸ்ட்ரென்த் ஆஃப் த பிளாஸ்ட், செகண்ட் ஒன் இஸ் ரேஞ்ச் ஃப்ரம் த டீடோனேஷன் அண்ட் தேர்ட் ஒன் இஸ் சரௌண்டிங் என்விரான்மெண்ட். ஓகே, ஸோ the lung blast will cause two responses. One is immediate response and delayed response. In that, the immediate, there is an immediate bradycardia and apnea. Okay, what is the reason behind this immediate bradycardia and apnea is due to your vagal immediate reflex. Okay, it's not because of your blood loss and all, it's the worst case vagal immediate reflex. Okay, whatever happening in the early immediate cause of death in case of burn also. Okay, vagal immediate reflex. Okay, and there is a lung injury itself is typified by alveolar capillary rupture. In subsequent intrapulmonary bleeding and edema. Okay, the extent of injury is proportional to the blast exposure and it may range from microscopic petechial hemorrhage to the areas of frank hemorrhage. Okay, so microscopically it will happen as a petechial injury and to a frank hemorrhage presentation. So then one more fact what they are telling it, that the clinical feature of blast injury include progressive hypoxia, not a simple hypoxia, it's a progressive hypoxia which may not be apparent at the time of injury and it's related to the inflammatory response to the intrapulmonary hemorrhage and worsening edema. That's what you have to note. Then there is a pneumothoraxis, hemothoraxis, and the last thing is air embolism. What is the reason behind this air embolism means? It's due to a fistula formed between this arteriovenous and the veno bronchovenous. Arteriovenous, bronchovenous, there is a fistula is there. Because of the fistula, air embolism is happening, it causes acute hypoxia with the cardiovascular collapse and is the leading cause of death in those who do not survive anti treatment. So the MCQ is, what is the leading cause of death in those who do not survive until treatment is your air embolism. Okay. Then in this radiograph, your typical battering pulmonary infiltration will be there. That is also another MCQ. Okay. So treatment of blast lung is for a large supportive. So
in the tapas.
Yeah, I will tell you. So yes, you have to use a profile. They are telling that the mechanical ventilation you know when to use. Okay, but they are telling that one new thing: prophylactic bilateral pleural decompression. Okay. That is also, there is little evidence to suggest an effect of outcome. So patients with significant blast lung injuries are highly to have sustained other blast related injuries and many management plans should be considered in the overall conditions. So this box is very important. This box is MCQ. Okay. And the secondary blast is mainly injury because of your penetration fragmentations. Okay. By the particles. So the particles of this bomb is there now, the explosions. The thing. What are the things I will tell later? That because of these fragmentations, the things, the glass pieces, everything will penetrate, that will cause, that is called secondary blast. Okay, because of all penetrating injuries. The tertiary blast is because of this crowding, okay, this large particles like surrounding vehicles which will injure the patient, which will injure the people while during blast and all, it comes under tertiary blast. This is examples are your blunt and crush injuries and traumatic amputations. So they will ask this question, traumatic amputation is come under tertiary blast. Okay. Yeah, the penetrating injuries will come under secondary blast, but the blunt and crush injuries are tertiary blast. Okay. So blunt and crush injuries and traumatic amputations are tertiary blast. Okay. Penetrating injuries are secondary blast. So this quaternary blast is because of your burn and inhalation injuries. Okay. And this quinary blast is because of that radiation effect. Okay. So radiation sickness, infection. Okay, it is a very, very chronic stages. In chronic form only it will come, the quinary blast and all. So based upon example is your radiation sickness infection. Okay, this is very important. These examples and the injury types will ask. Okay. So what is the incidence of abdominal injury in case of a primary blast is seen around 3%. Okay, that is very important. Okay, the 3% is your abdominal injury. So next is in the abdomen. Okay, what are the all organs are those most commonly injured? What is the order of this injury? First one is your cecum, followed by your terminal ileum, followed by your mesentery. just to see, cecum segment is probably most sensitive to intestinal blast injury. That is important. So, which part of the bowel is very sensitive to intestinal blast injury is cecum. Okay. And conversely, the small bowel and its extensive mesentery may be more susceptible to a large shear waves causing mesenteric tearing. Okay. Just remember the terms. So, most sensitive to intestinal blast injury, direct question, it will be a cecum segment. Okay. And more, which of the injury is more susceptible to large shear waves? The wave like that word is came that it that will be your small bowel. Okay. So small bowel and its extensive mesentery. So so next, the presentation of the primary blast injury to the bowel may be delayed relative to the acute onset of blast length. Okay. It may be delayed. Okay. That we remember. Then the most common operative finding of an intestinal blast injury is subserosal hemorrhage. That is our institute. Okay. Then next, then the solid organs are most resistant to primary blast. Another fact. Okay. The solid organs are most resistant. What is the most sensitive to intestinal blast injuries or cecum and susceptible to the large shear waves? And all your small bowel and dysentery. Okay. Any other MCQ here? Any other MCQ? Primary blast.
No.
Low pressure injuries. You have a.
So secondary blast injuries refer to the effect of fragments that are accelerated away from the device following detonation. Okay, they're because of this fragment and penetration. Okay, penetrating objects. What we have seen. These are the sources of the fragments, like casting of the device. Okay, and nails, balls, ball bearings. Okay, and nearby objects like glasses, stones. So these are the examples for the sources of the fragments. Okay, so what is the MCQ here is, in contrast to bullet wounds, the variability of the fragments producing a wide range of movements, and no two wounds will be look like same. So that is a differentiation between the bullet wound and these fragmentation wounds. The fragmentation wounds, so no two wounds will be the same. Okay, and the irregular surface of the fragments causes a complex pattern of yaw and temple, and both permanent and temporary wound cavities may be unpredictable and irregular. Okay, so that's the next MCQ is, what is the indication of yearly removal of these fragmentations? Okay, what is the indication for yearly removal? What is the late indication? The yearly removal indication is where fragment within the joint space and adjacent to the structures with the danger of erosion and further injuries. Late indication is the removal of ongoing sepsis, pain, or lack of function. Okay, so the patient yearly removal is, just remember, any fragment within the joint space you have to remove yearly, and adjacent to the structure with the danger of erosion. Okay, and further injuries you have to remove yearly. The late indication is a sepsis, pain, and lack of function. The tertiary blast injury is the result of the grass movement of the personal object or infrastructure with the blast wind. Okay, so that is your tertiary injury. So it's a grass movement of the personal object. See, personal object or infrastructure with the blast wound. Tertiary wound in the MCQ is the traumatic amputations is come under this category. Just remember, but they gave one term is one word also. Although primarily blast, under the shattering effect on bone may play a part. Okay, even this traumatic amputation, this primary blast also play a part under this shattering effect. Shattering effect on the bone means I think that is mainly because of this secondary blast. That's also make a play, but in the box they given that tertiary amputation will come under tertiary blast. Okay, remember. And the quaternary and quinary injury, this quaternary refers to a miscellaneous group, okay, of injuries and do not fall within the other category. So miscellaneous group is where quaternary. Okay, this includes burns, inhalation injuries, and late onset respiratory problems. Your early onset problem because of your primary blast length, and the late onset because of your quaternary. Just see the word and all. The late because of quaternary. And quinary means, it's a very novel concept, and it's caused by the intentional addition of either biologically or radioactively active material to an explosive device. Okay. Okay. Because of example is radiation sickness and infections. Okay. So environmental effect. The environmental effect. So your the shock wave of blast pressure is modified by an enclosed and partially enclosed space. Okay. So your higher rates of blast lung and TM ruptures are seen following enclosed blast. Okay. in which both the casualty and blast are enclosed. Okay. In contrary, the secondary blast injuries may be lower in number as more people are protected from energetic fragments. So I have found one MCQ here. What is it? This mortality from underbody blast is most commonly caused by head injury. The underbody blast and a non-compressible torso hemorrhage, including aortic disruption and liver laceration. Okay. So infection, no MCQ.
Underbody, what is underbody?
Underbody means
underwater. And
underbody blast means sir what?
Underwater.
Yeah, under only body only will be under the water. Oh, no. I will tell actually. I have taken notes actually.
Okay, see you in the letter. Continue.
Any other MCQ? Yes. I didn't found any after this.
No.
This infection no, also, no, infection no, also not there. Is infection also they are telling that about the
blast injury is very important.
Blast injury, na? Okay. After that, so remember this fact, okay? This high pressure wound lavage has shown to increase the bacterial propagation in the soft tissue and is not indicated.
That's what already for now, pulse jet lavage.
With the few exceptions such as facial wounds, with the few exceptions such as facial wound, closure of the contaminated war wounds should not be performed. This is also already told. Okay. Except facial wound, you should not close the other wound. Okay, that's it.
Hey, from tomorrow, which class? Very good.